certainly we do give God praise for all that he has done for us. Even this past week, these last 2 days. And I tell you, we're jumping from one mountain peak to the next. And I just thank God for just this worship experience over these past 2 days. Has anybody's heart been blessed this week?
Amen.
Has anybody been blessed this week?
Amen.
Has anybody been encouraged this week? Amen. Amen. How many of y'all prayed at 12 o'clock? Raise your hand. Amen. 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 If you didn't pray at 12 o'clock, y'all can be bowing your head right now and praying right now. Amen. Amen. And at this time, without any further ado, I want to present to us our evangelist, Pastor Charles Tuck Jr. Amen.
Amen.
One last time.
Amen.
Amen. This series of revival night. Amen. Just continue with the man of God. He has preached from his heart. Amen. These two nights. Amen. And I pray that we are all blessed and encouraged. Not to just bottle this word up and just keep it to ourselves. Amen. But to run and go tell that.
Yeah.
Amen. Somebody needs to know. What
yes,
it is that we have learned on this week. Amen. And so without any further ado, the next worship we will hear after the sermonic hymn given by Pastor Jadarius Irvin. Amen. Y'all missed that. Y'all missed that. Pastor. Pastor Jadarius Irvin. Amen. Last time he was with us, he was associate minister. Amen. To Darius Irvin. And now he is pastor to Darius Irvin. He is going to come and give us our sermonic hymn. The next words you will hear, the next voice you will hear will be that of our evangelist for the week, Pastor Charles Tuck. Amen.
Amen.
I was young. But I recall,
my Lord.
Singing songs, was my mother's joy, as the shadows, gathered at the close.
you now for just you being who you are. You being God, being God all by yourself. Thank you for this day. Thank you for keeping us from danger seen and unseen. You allowed us to make it back into your house of worship one more time. Now, Lord God, we come to the moment of preaching. And Lord God, we ask now that you would strengthen us for the assignment. We pray now that you would give substance to this sermon. Lord God, our repetition is that if someone doesn't know you, Lord, or know their sin, then after the word has gone forth and the invitation has been extended, if someone will run crying, Lord, what must I do to be saved? Thank you for your darling son, Jesus. Thank you for your darling son, Jesus. Thank you for your darling son, Jesus. Thank you for the work that he did on the hill called Calvary. And we also thank you that early Thursday morning, he got up with all power in his hands. We bless you, praise your name for what you're going to do in this place. And it's in the name of him that died but yet lives, Jesus the Christ, our Lord and our Savior, we pray and we ask it all. Amen. God bless you. What a mighty God we serve. Yes. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth are going. Yes. What a mighty God we serve. So we bless the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, for yet this day that was not promised to us. We certainly give honor to our host pastor this week. Come on, once again, for the last time tonight, let's celebrate Pastor Donald III. While we're thanking God for our Reverend Garnett, let's thank God for Sister Garnett. Amen. To my fellow carriers of the cargo of Calvary, Reverend Jacoby Urban, amen. And Pastor Jadarius Urban, amen. And the Elysian Fields Baptist Church. And the only reason why he ain't the pastor of the New Hope Baptist Church in Nacogdoches is because I wouldn't let them hold an election. He came through my church for my youth revival and just proceeded to tear up everything. I'm still trying to put my church back together.
Amen.
We thank God for his presence here on tonight. He totally shocked me. He drove, amen, from Marshall, Texas, all the way up here. And that's not a short drive. And just him being here speaks volumes of our friendship and his fellowship that he shares with this church. And we're grateful. Not too many preachers would get in their car and drive 5 minutes down the road to a church. Amen. But he came all this way. And we're certainly grateful. We're definitely yet praying for him and the Elysian Fields Church family. But also the members of the St. Emmanuel Baptist Church, amen, to each of you, my brothers and sisters of the laity, once again, it's been another good day. Amen. We are grateful and thankful for the Lord smiling upon us once again. Amen. Once again, let's give this youth ministry another hand. Well, I served all week long. And they have done a magnificent job in the worship service on this week. Amen. The worship service, I've just enjoyed myself during my time at the same thing. Amen. Excuse me, this tour of St. Emmanuel Baptist Amen. Church.
Amen. Amen.
And I thank God for your pastor, for his willingness to allow me to come all this way.
Amen.
Like I said, he knows a plethora of preachers far more able and far more better. But we're grateful that he looked down I-20 down towards Nacogdoches and allowed us to come this way. And I'm extremely humbled and honored to have been given this opportunity to stand in the pulpit where he stands every Sunday morning.
Amen, amen.
And I pray that something had been said or done this week that would help you run on
amen.
Until
amen.
You hear him saying, well done.
Yes, yes.
I've given you all that I've got these first two nights, and I know this is the closeout night, and I'm going to tell you what Pastor William Timothy Glenn of the Mount Olive Church told us. He said, a train doesn't come in full speed, and it doesn't leave full speed. Amen. I've literally given you all that I got these first two nights. I need your prayers.
Amen.
And I need a whole lot of your amens on tonight.
Amen.
This is a youth revival. And this sermon, hopefully, will not only bless the young folk, but hopefully it will bless us seasoned saints on tonight. Thank you for those who joined me in a word of prayer today at 12 noon. That's what I ask every time I go to a revival. Thank you. If you pray all the past two days that I told you, thank you so much. Even if you just pray today, God bless you. Thank you. I believe that preaching and prayer are like Siamese twins. They go together. Amen. So thank you so much. Thank you for all your hospitality that you have shown unto me this week. I'm talking now because I promise you, the biggest lie preacher tells us, we ain't going to be up here long. And I lied last night. I'm not going to be long tonight. Amen. I'm not going to be long. I promise you. I'm not going to be as long-winded as I was last night. There are a couple of passages of scripture I'm going to try and lift up. The first one is found in John chapter 18. Gospel according to John. I ask that when you get some private time, and I'm not going to read all of it. I ask you to get some private time that you would read it in its entirety, but for the sake of time, thank you for standing for the reading of the Word of God. I shall lift up verses 15 through 18, then I shall scroll down and read verses 25 and 26. Then I shall go to John chapter 21, verse 15 through 18. John 18, verses 15 through 18, and then I will skip down and read 25 and 26. Then I shall read John 21. You're still looking and say, hold on. The Holy Writ declares, and Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. That disciple was known unto the high priest, and went in with Jesus unto the palace of the high priest. But Jesus stood at the door without. Then went out that other disciple, which was known unto the high priest, and spoke unto her, who kept the door, and brought in Peter. Then said the damsel that kept the door unto Peter, are you not also one of this man's disciples? And he said, I am not. Whoa. The servants and officers stood there and made a fire of coals, for it was cold. They warmed themselves. Peter stood with them and warmed himself. Go to verse 25. Holy Writ declares, and Simon Peter stood and warmed himself. They said therefore unto him, are you not also one of his disciples? He denied it and said, I am not. One of the servants of the high priest, being his kinsman, whose ear Peter cut off, said, did not I see you in the garden with him? I'll read verse 27. Peter then denied again, and immediately the rooster crowed. Amen. Skip down, go to John chapter 21. John chapter number 21. There, I shall commence the reading at verse 15. So when they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these? He said unto him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said unto him, feed my lambs. He said to him the second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? He said unto him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said unto him, feed my sheep. Said unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he had said unto him the third time, do you love me? And he said unto him, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said unto him, feed my sheep. Amen. God bless you. The grass withered, the flower faded away, but the word of our God shall stand forever. Yes, just for the time that is ours to share together here tonight, I'm going to have to tag this text with this thought, your failure is in vain.
All right.
Your failure isn't fine. Amen. God bless you. I like to start this sermon by asking a question, and I want you all to be honest with me tonight. You can't lie, we're in church. Tell the truth. By a show of hands, how many of us have made a mistake? Amen. I thought I'd be in pretty good company tonight. Does not matter whether you're young or you're old, all of us have missed the mark.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
All of us, my brothers and my sisters, have messed up. All of us in here, we haven't dotted every I.
No.
Y'all go ahead and do that. We haven't crossed every T. We haven't always been perfect. I submit unto you this evening that that most of us, if not all of us are here, we've said some things we had no business of saying.
That's right.
All of us in here, we've gone to some places we had no business of going. I even submit unto you, we've all done some stuff we certainly had no business doing. We hadn't always walked the straight and narrow. Now, y'all can take the halo off your head tonight. Take the halo off your head tonight. Because I don't care how many crosses you wear around your neck. I don't care how many songs you can sing, how many Bible verses you can quote. All of us in here have fallen short. All of us in here have missed the mark. And sadly and unfortunately, I submit unto you on tonight that the problem isn't in making a mistake.
Yeah.
Because life, as you go on with life, my father said, he used to tell us all the time that life doesn't come with instruction manuals. Some things you have to learn through trial and error.
Right.
But he said the mistake ain't in making the mistake, because that's going to happen. You ain't going to be perfect. You ain't going to do everything right all the time. The first mistake is acting as if you never done nothing.
That's true. Go ahead.
Because there's a whole lot of folk that act as if since the time they came out the womb to the time they're in now, they ain't never done. I know I told y'all this is going to be a tough sermon tonight. They ain't never done nothing.
Go ahead.
And then the second mistake is that people who have failed and who have missed the mark, they're usually handcuffed to the mistakes that they made. Y'all lean in tonight. Now, you're probably saying, Tuck, that's a pretty rough way of starting your sermon. Yes, it is. And let me tell you something. Not only have we let ourselves down, but there have been plenty of times where we let the Lord Jesus Christ down. To me on the side. There have been plenty of times where we have let the Lord Jesus Christ down. You got the Bible. You know the word. But there have been times where you deliberately disobeyed what God had told you to do. He told you to love your enemies, but yet you find yourself going the opposite. He told you to pay your tithes, but yet you find yourself going the opposite. He told you to go out there and make disciples, but yet you find yourself doing the opposite. All of us have let the Lord Jesus Christ down.
That's right.
Now, like I said, that's a pretty rough way of starting a sermon, but I don't want to leave you there looking all sad, depressed, and grim. There is some good news. Can I tell you the good news? The good news tonight is that even though you've messed up in life, the good news is even though you let the Lord down in life, the good news is even though you've missed the mark, you do not have to be labeled and defined and handcuffed by the mistakes that you made in your life. All right, y'all ready tonight? I'm going to say it again at the risk of sounding redundant. You do not have to be handcuffed and labeled and defined by the mistakes that you made in your life. You do not have to be shackled by your past. I wish I had a witness in here. Let myself a note. You're not going to get no amens on this, but say it anyway. One of the main reasons
death. That means the drug addict has no business talking about the prostitute. The prostitute has no business talking about the shacker. The shacker has no business talking about the alcoholic. The alcoholic has no business talking about the gambler. The gambler has no business talking about the hellraiser. The hellraiser has no business talking about the liar. The liar has no business talking about anybody. Oh, listen here. Let's stop. Let's stop. But the Lord is shouting new things. And even though we mess up, even though we're flawed, even though we have failures, here's another thing to shout on. God can look past all of your flaws. God can look past all of your faults. God can look past all of your failures and still use you anyway. Lord, y'all gonna act brand new on me tonight. I said, in spite of your flaws, in spite of your failures, in spite of your issues, God can still look past all of that and use you anyway. Now look here, that may not shock y'all, but that sure shouts me. You just added 10 more minutes to my introduction. Y'all don't believe me. I said, you ain't got to be perfect in order to be used by God.
Yeah.
You just have to be available. Do you not know if the qualifications and the criteria for you to be used by God, you have to be perfect? None of us.
That's right.
Nobody would have ever been used.
That's right.
Like I said, y'all don't believe me.
Okay.
Abraham.
Yeah.
Abraham was alive. He told Pharaoh that Sarah was his sister, not his wife. But God still made Abraham the father of many nations. Noah was an alcoholic. Noah liked to stop at the saloon and get drunk every now and then. But Noah was the one that God told him to preach and it was going to rain. And he used Noah to build the ark. David was a murderer. He took another man's life and took another man's wife. But he was still a man after God. I wish I had a witness of that. The Apostle Peter at a low point. We see the Apostle Peter at a weak point. Now, out of all 12 of the disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, there was not one more outspoken.
That's right.
There was not one more brash. There was not one that was more impatient than the Apostle Peter. Peter had some good moments. It was Peter who walked on the water. But yet Peter had some bad moments. Because the same Peter that walked on the water, he doubted and they started looking at his circumstances and they wound up sinking. It was the same Peter that cut off that man's ear the night that Jesus was arrested. Look at the text. Are y'all with me? I think that your Bible's open. Peter now was at a low point. It has been a long and difficult day for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ had already instituted the Lord's Supper. He had already girded a towel and washed his disciples' feet. He had already gone to the Garden of Gethsemane. He had prayed, and now the Sanhedrin and all of them have now gathered and arrested Jesus illegally, might I add, and now have taken him to the high priest's house. So now Jesus, my brothers and my sisters, is now being tried illegally at the house of Caiaphas. My brother, my sister, the other gospel says he went to Caiaphas first. But John tells us that Annas tried him first.
Yeah.
Now, this moment of Peter was so powerful that all four gospel writers detail the denial of Peter.
Yeah.
It's very rare when all four gospels mention an event that took place either in the life of Jesus or even in the life of his disciples. That there are some things we can learn from this text that is purgatory to our walk toward the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And after I tell you, we'll be through. And now, like I said, this look here. Now, if you're perfect, this part of the sermon ain't for you.
If you ain't
never done nothing, you need to get up and walk out right now. Because this sermon ain't for you. But I need to talk to the folk that know you've been jacked up. I need to talk to the blind folk. I need to talk to the real folk. Y'all need to keep it real. Too many times we come to church with a mask on. We don't want nobody to know we're human. But I need to talk to the real folk tonight that knows that they haven't always got it right all the time.
Yeah.
Peter's getting ready to be put to the test.
Uh-huh.
And Peter failed the test. How many of y'all, you failed the test before? Was with Peter. Some people say it was Joseph of Arimathea. Some say it was Nicodemus. But the Bible says that Peter and this other disciple go in to where the high priest is.
Uh-huh.
The high priest knew who this disciple was. They didn't know who Peter was.
Yeah.
Peter gets access to this area. First thing we have to look at here, and the first thing that will help us in our walk with Jesus Christ, you got to watch where you go.
Yeah. Oh, that's right. Tell the truth.
Jesus had problems with the religious folk. It was a earth. And here in the text, Peter is in a place where nothing but trouble is lurking. These are our people that can't stand the Lord Jesus Christ. And look here, it's something about when you end up in the wrong place at the wrong time. 9.910 times, trouble is sure to follow. Young people, the parents tell you don't go there. You ought to listen to your parents. When they tell you don't be out in the park late at night, you ought to try to find your way home on the street next time. There's a whole lot of children that are in the graveyard because they were in the place at the wrong time. There's a whole lot of people that are in jail right now because they were in the wrong place at the wrong time. To deal with this issue. But he wasn't strong enough in ourselves. How many times we made that mistake? We thought we were strong enough to handle the situation. Now, once again, I made it in my mind. I ain't gonna get to put any hands on it. I might not get invited back on that. But like I said, there's a place you ought not go. Now look here, if you struggle with gambling, don't go to street school. Struggle with drinking, don't go to the bar. If you struggle with smoking, don't go to the tobacco bar. Lord, y'all trying to bring all this home. Look here, the devil knows what you like. The devil ain't gonna wave in front of you stuff you don't like. The devil waving stuff in front of you that you do like. And too many times, we put ourselves in the situation that we in. We put ourselves in the situation that we're in. Sometimes we give the devil way too much credit. Some of the stuff that we bring on ourselves, we did it to ourselves. Can I blame the devil? Can I blame the divine? We did it to ourselves. Don't blame the devil. Your blood pressure's up. When you were the one that had the pig feet, the pork chop, the pig feet, and the pig tail, you did that to yourself. Some stuff we did to ourselves. Here Peter is. He's hanging around the wrong pole. He's warming himself around the enemy's fire. But secondly, not only do you have to watch where you go, but you have to watch what you say. Look at the text.
Look at the text.
One little girl says, hey, you were with Jesus. You were one of the ones that were with him. And look at what Peter said. I don't know what you're talking about. And look here, my brothers and my sisters, when you walk with the Lord,
yes.
I don't care how much you try to hide it, somebody's going to know who you. They know you go to St. Amen.
Amen.
They know you go to New Hope, and they know where you go. They know they have seen Peter with the Savior. But Peter was so strong that somebody recognized him that he quickly said, when Jesus told his disciples that he was getting ready to go be crucified, he said, one of you will betray me, talking about Judas Iscariot. And then Peter, Peter, he was outspoken. Peter said, Lord, all these other folk might leave you, but I'll never leave you. I'll die for you.
That's right. Yeah.
My God.
And the Lord said, would you? He said, I'll tell you what, before the cock crows, you shall deny me three times. Peter said, Lord, I'm with you. Lord, I won't do anything like it. But now the rubber has met the road.
That's right.
Now he's in a situation where he has to put his words into action. And the first test that came, somebody says, you were with him. He says, I don't know who you're talking about. Can I tell you Peter's second mistake? Not only did he have self-confidence in himself, but if you notice, the Bible says that when Jesus was getting ready to go into the courtyard, the Bible says Peter followed But then at some point, we drifted away. We became like the Apostle Peter. We started following him from afar off. And the further away you get from Jesus, the closer you get to trouble. And so one little girl says, hey, you with him? He says, no, I don't know what you're talking about. The Bible says that he moves from there, goes around the fire, he's warming himself. Somebody else speaks up and says, hey, no, this ain't deja vu. You was with Jesus. I know you was with him. I saw you when you went with him to raise Lazarus from the dead. I saw you when you fed a multitude of 5,000. I saw you when he healed your mother-in-law. You was with Jesus. He said, no, there must be some other fellow. You got the wrong wall. You, and then the third time, there was that man who was peeing to the person that Peter cut his ear on. He said, yeah, it was you. You're a guy. Yeah, it was you. And then Peter got mad and began to curse and swear, I do not know what you're talking about. Lean in.
All right.
Peter said, I'll go with you all the way to death. The Lord said that you will deny me 3 times.
Yes.
Like I said, once again, we can't get on the Apostle Peter too hard. Because how many of us in here have made the Lord promises that we broke? How many of us told the Lord we'll do something and we broke it? How many of us told the Lord, Lord, if you get me off my sick bed, I'll start coming to church? There's some people that the Lord has healed. They ain't been to church since Christmas. How many of us said, Lord, you come to get this job? I paid my tithes and my offering. The Lord has blessed us with time with the job, and instead of paying our tithes and offering, we still put a dollar in the offering plate. How many of us, we promised the Lord something, but yet when the Lord came through for us, we reneged on our word? That's why you have to be real careful what you say, what you will do, and what you say that you won't do.
Yes.
Y'all with me? That are willing to say I'm a Christian when they come to church.
Yeah.
But they hide their Bible Can you?
Yeah, yeah.
Y'all ain't with me. I gotta go.
Yeah, yeah. Go ahead.
I'm almost through. I told you I'm gonna be before you long. But then, I must tell you, what you have to do after you made a mistake.
That's it.
The Bible says Peter showed remorse. Because after he did this, he saw the Lord Jesus Christ.
Uh-huh.
And he went out and wept bitterly.
Yeah.
Now, here's the difference between making a mistake and forming a habit. When you make a mistake, you're truly sorry for the mistake that you made.
Oh, yes.
And you got to show remorse. Now, if you keep doing wrong and you don't see the problem in doing what you're doing, that's no longer a mistake. That's a habit.
Yeah.
Peter showed us remorse in the text when he wept tears. Here's how you do it. Look here. There's no mistake that God won't forgive you of.
That's right.
And when you mess up, you ought to be willing to fall down on your knees and say, Lord God Jesus, I'm sorry.
Yes,
I know I messed up.
Yes,
I know I've done wrong. Please forgive me.
Yes.
I'm through. I see home in your faces. Not only must you watch where you go. Not only must you watch what you say. Not only must you know what to do after you made a mistake.
Uh-huh.
But lastly, I must tell you why Jesus didn't throw Peter away.
Help us.
John 21.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Jesus had already went to the cross.
Uh-huh.
He had died.
Mm-hmm.
He got up early Sunday morning. I thought this is a Baptist church. I said, Jesus died. He got up early Sunday morning. John 21, you read the gospel Bible quick, right? But John 21, he keeps writing.
Uh-huh.
Jesus Christ asked the other disciples to join him, and he includes Peter. Now, nobody would have blamed the Lord Jesus had he thrown Peter away.
Yeah.
Nobody would have blamed Jesus had he threw shade at Peter's nose.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
Because you know, had it been us, had somebody would have denied us, we would have got up and said, hey, oh wait, now you know who I am?
Uh-huh.
Now you recognize me?
Yeah.
Get away from me, Peter. I don't have fun with you no more. Look at what Jesus does. Jesus doesn't throw Peter away.
Yeah.
But Jesus asked him three times,
listen.
Simon, do you love me?
Yeah.
Peter said, Lord, you know I love you. He asked you again. He says, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know I do. He asked one more time. He says, Peter, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And look at what Jesus says. Jesus says, feed my sheep.
Yeah.
Now, I know I'm from the country, but he ain't talking about real sheep.
Yeah.
He ain't talking about no sheep in the field.
Uh-huh.
But he's talking about people.
Yes.
And when he says feed them,
yeah,
he ain't talking about with food.
Yeah.
He's talking about with the word of God.
Yes,
in other words, Jesus didn't throw Peter away because he had more work for Peter to do.
Yeah.
Now, that ain't shot at y'all. And look here. But let me tell you what shot at me when I read it. The main reason why Jesus Christ didn't throw Peter away,
uh-huh,
and I'm in my seat, it's because Jesus didn't see Peter for who he was in John 18.
Uh-huh.
But he saw Peter for what he was going to become in Acts chapter 2.
Go ahead.
Lord Jesus, come on. It was in Acts chapter 2 where Peter stood up and preached on the day of Pentecost.
Yeah.
And thousands of souls were added to the Lord's church. Y'all missed it. God gave Peter another chance.
Yeah.
I said God gave Peter another chance. Y'all should have shouted right there. I said God gave Peter another chance. I said God gave Peter. I said he gave Peter another chance. He did not give Peter a second chance, but he gave Peter another chance. And I'm wondering, is there anybody here that can testify with me that the God that we serve, he's able to give you another chance? He's